let us discuss about cryptococcosis or torulosis. Okay, cryptococcus or torulosis. Remember, this is a fungal infection. Okay, this is a fungal infection. Let us see what is this fungal infection, how it causes, what are its clinical manifestation, what are its complications, how it is diagnosed and what is treatment. Okay, first, it is, the definition is, it is a subacute or chronic infection. It is a subacute or chronic infection caused by Cryptococcus neoformans. Caused by Cryptococcus neoformans. Cryptococcus neoformans. Or by some other fungi like Cryptococcus albidus, Cryptococcus larensi. Okay, even these two, this organism, this fungi also can cause cryptococcosis, but the most important pathogenic organism here is Cryptococcus neoformans. The main difference between this Cryptococcus albidens and Cryptococcus larensia and Cryptococcus neoformans is this Cryptococcus neoformans, it can grow at 37 degrees, and it can hydrolyze urea. It can hydrolyze urea. These two are the important differences between other pathogenic Cryptococcus and Cryptococcus neoformans. And one more thing we have to remember is, this Cryptococcus, they are yeast cells. They are yeast fungi, okay? They are yeast forms. Remember this. They are yeast forms. Okay, I told you the difference between Cryptococcus neoformans and other Cryptococcus. Okay? This fungi is mostly found in the soil. Okay? It is found in the soil and bird feces. Especially pigeon feces. So we can say that when the soil is contaminated by this pigeon feces, when we inhale such contaminated soil, then we'll suffer from the disease. Okay, remember this. And in animals, this Cryptococcus neoformans can cause mastitis. In animals, it can cause mastitis. Okay, the main virulence factors of this Cryptococcus neoformans is, virulence factors are mainly, it has got polysaccharide capsule. It has got polysaccharide capsule. Okay, and the second one is, it can synthesize melanin. Okay, melanin synthesis can take place. It can synthesize melanin. This is by an enzyme called phenyl oxidase. This synthesis takes place with the help of an enzyme called phenyl oxidase. Phenyl oxidase. This enzyme helps in the synthesis of melanin. Okay, and it can also produce some other enzymes like phospholipase and urease. Other enzymes like phospholipase and one more enzyme is urease. I told you right here the main difference between Cryptococcus and Cryptococcus neoformans and other pathogenic Cryptococcus, it can hydrolyze urease, right? This hydrolyzation will take with the help of urease enzyme. Okay, and one more important thing that we have to remember is, this Cryptococcus neoformans or Cryptococcus, it can cross blood-brain barrier. It can cross blood-brain barrier. This crossing can take place by crossing endothelium, or otherwise, this microorganism can be carried by macrophages to the brain. Okay, macrophages can carry this microorganism to the CNS, or otherwise it can directly cross endothelium. Okay, this is about virulence factors. Now coming to pathogenicity. I told you they are present in the soil, especially in the fields of Pisium. So when the soil is contaminated by with the when soil is contaminated with such Pisium feces, if we inhale such soil, then we will suffer from the disease. Okay, hence the main route of spread is inhalation. Inhalation is the route of spread. As the inhalation is the route of spread, so lungs will be the first organ to be affected, right? Lungs will be the first organ to be affected. Here, if when the lungs are involved, we'll see that the manifestation will be pulmonary cryptococcosis. Okay, cryptococcosis. Most of the time, the disease caused by this cryptococcus is most often it is asymptomatic. Okay, most of the time it is asymptomatic. Rarely, when the person is immunocompromised, in such condition we'll see these diseases, right? So when the lung is involved, we'll see pulmonary cryptococcosis. Okay, when dissemination takes place, if there is dissemination usually takes place in immunocompromised, as all of us know. Okay, when dissemination takes place, there will be involvement of visceral organs. There will be involvement of skin. There will be involvement of meninges. Okay, especially if take visceral organ, this when there is involvement of visceral organ, this look as if it is tuberculosis. This looks as if it is tuberculosis and cancer. Okay, the symptoms in tuberculosis and cancer will be manifested. Okay, and sometimes even bones and joints can also be seen. Joint involvement can also be seen. Okay, then coming to involvement of skin, that is cutaneous. The manifestation range from small ulcers to large granulomata. Okay, the manifestation results from will be manifested as small ulcers to sometimes even large granulomata. Okay, if take meninges, as I told you, they can cross blood-brain barriers, right? So when meninges are involved, they mimic tuberculosis meningitis. And one thing we have to remember is this is the most serious type. Okay, when meninges are involved, this will be the most serious type. And this usually seen in AIDS patients. And this is about meningeal involvement. Then moving to laboratory diagnosis. In laboratory diagnosis, we mainly do microscopy and culture. Okay, in microscopy, if you see, we'll use Indian ink preparation. In Indian ink preparation, what happens is we'll see here is in Indian ink preparation, capsulated budding cells are seen. Okay, capsulated budding cells are seen. And one more thing is that this capsule will be enlarged. You'll see that a prominent capsule will be seen. Okay, capsule will be very prominent in Indian ink preparation. We'll see this in diagram. We'll see here the capsule is very very prominent, right? So this is Indian ink preparation. You'll see here the capsule is very very prominent. Okay, the capsule is very prominent. Other stains that we can use are Gram stain, Mussy Carmine stain, Mason Fontana Stain and Alkane Blue Stain. These are the important stains that we use for Cryptococcus neoformans. And then move into culture. In culture, we'll use SDA agar. We'll see smooth mucoid colonies, creamy colored colonies. Okay, and we can also establish pathogenicity by inoculating the specimen into the mouse. Okay, by inoculation into mouse, especially by intracerebral inoculation and intraperitoneal inoculation. If we inoculate intraperitoneally or intracerebrally into the mouse, then that mouse will develop infection. This can be laboratory, we can diagnose this infection. Okay, and we can also identify capsular antigen. Okay, this capsular antigen can be identified by some precipitation reactions like latex agglutination test. Agglutination. Okay, this is about laboratory diagnosis. Then move into treatment. Treatment. Here, if there is no CNS involvement, if the cryptococcus is without CNS involvement, then the drug of choice is fluconazole. Fluconazole is the drug of choice. If there is CNS involvement, especially in AIDS patients, in such cases, what we'll do here we'll use two things. One is induction phase, another one is maintenance phase. In induction phase, what we'll do here is we'll give amphotericin plus or minus flucytosine. Okay, this is induction. Thereafter we'll give maintenance phase. With fluconazole. This is for lifelong. Okay, first we will give induction phase, then followed by maintenance phase. Induction phase is with amphotericin plus or minus flucytosine, then followed by maintenance phase with fluconazole, which is given lifelong. Okay, this is about cryptococcosis. Thank you for watching.